divine harmony, of which the temporal and spatial cosmos is a reflection, but of which is merely a reflection.
Of which it is merely a reflection.
Hence, the superficial chords which for fallen man give the lie to the profound beauty of the image as a whole totality that he cannot see, being by definition cut off from the vision. And you go on to say that people are cut off by their limited vision. They just don't see the tapestry, but they see these random threads, and they miss out on the meaning of the whole. And Shakespeare's play draws the audience into the slice of life portrayed in the drama and characters, and the lack of the vision and the cold objectivity is changed into what you call warmth of subjectivity. This statement is so beautifully done and contains so much of the essence of your book that I'd like you to comment a little more on that statement, that drawing of the audience which has that cold objectivity into that warmth of subjectivity.
Well, this is rather a personal question, but it's what one does experience. One is drawn, the audience go to the theatre to be spellbound. They want to enter into the, they don't bother about that. They want to enter into the play. I mean, it's a wonderful pastime, as it were, to be drawn into the play. And where a play is the story of a great soul which is being purified of its faults, and restored to the original perfection of man as he was created in the image of God. It is, and that is what Shakespeare's great plays are about. It is, or can be, a wonderful experience to be drawn into this tapestry from the wrong side, and to be drawn out on the other side, and to partake of subjectively, because one's cold objectivity at the beginning has been changed to something of a warm subjectivity. One is now on the right side of the tapestry. One has been drawn through it. One is partially identified with the protagonists of the play, and once one enters into their feelings, and one partakes mysteriously of, even that's the best thing one can do, one partakes mysteriously of the purification that is going on in the soul of the hero and the heroine, if there are two people, because sometimes there's a duality in Shakespeare's plays which has to be considered. And I don't know how more to express that, but it can be. And when this is helped by other things, I mean, that is what religion is for. After all, the word religion means restoration. The prefix re is the restoration of the bond ligament between man and God, which was lost at the fall, a restoration of the bond between the human and the divine, which existed at the creation of Adam, and which was lost. The fall, one takes the fall, one has the right to take the representations of the fall of man allegorically. The images that he used, one is not compelled to take them literally. The eating of the apple, what one must take, one must accept, is the change from perfection to the loss of perfection, which has to be restored. Religion is a restoration of the bond between that existed in the beginning. And together with religion, the effect of a great play of Shakespeare can add tremendously to the effect. I mean, it can add.
Yes. You even state that here, that we participate naturally and almost involuntarily in the world of holiness. It's only a momentary glimpse, and it does not last, but it does make an imprint upon the soul which may not be easily effaced.
Yeah.
Beautiful words. The other part I wanted to look at is that many secondary features of William Shakespeare's plays suggest that the poet had the power to draw upon the transcendent. You make that point. And you say that contact with the transcendent is a secret, for it belongs to the domain of the mysteries. But the true and original purpose of art, the primal reason for its existence, is precisely to communicate secrets, not blurting them out, but by offering them, as it were, with half-open hand, by bringing them near and inviting us to approach. Beautiful words.
No, I'm very happy to hear you say that, but it is true.
When you look back upon it, how has Shakespeare's writing impacted your life, and does it still?
Well, I said recently to somebody, quite recently, that the more I look at Shakespeare's great plays, the higher my opinion of Shakespeare is. And that was said fairly recently, I mean, to somebody, because it is, one sees things, other things that one had had escaped from. But I think I've said in the book everything that I could say. That Shakespeare is not a gift, as Dante was, to the Middle Ages. Dante was a great gift from heaven to medieval Christendom, when in some ways the Christian civilization was nearing its height. The 13th century is a great century in the Near East too, as well as in Europe, the 12th and 13th century. The decay was beginning, and the decadence was beginning in the 14th century already, the end of the 14th century, and throughout the 15th century. Shakespeare was a throwback to the past. I'm convinced of that he represented. But nonetheless, fortunately, providentially, his plays have the grandeur, linguistically, of the Middle Ages. Shakespeare was very near in spirit to the Middle Ages himself, and his plays have the grandeur of the the Middle Ages, but they were not a gift of heaven to Christendom as Dante was. They were a gift to the Western world from the 17th century until the present day, and to no century more than to our own century. They are a gift from heaven. And Shakespeare's plays are for us just as much as they are for, as they were for his contemporaries. And they will be, so long as this world lasts, that they will be relevant. Very relevant. Dante is also, of course, relevant, but Dante was, as I say, a gift from heaven to Christendom, to the Christian civilization. Shakespeare is a gift to the whole world, one might say, being what it is, what the world has become, because he's a gift to the, you might say, the modern, the world as it is now has become without any particular division.
Well, I want to thank you so much for the time that you've given Dr. Lings for all of this interview and your patience for our camera changes and things. And
well, I hope, I thank you for your efforts, and I hope good will come of it.
I'm very happy that I've had the opportunity to capture Dr. Lings in this unique filmed interview. I know that you all agree with me that he has made an extraordinary contribution to Shakespeare scholarship, and that his own life exemplified not only the highest ideals of that scholarship, but he personally wrote about, talked about, lectured about things which were important to all of us outside of the world of Shakespeare scholarship in general. We have much to appreciate in the work of Dr. Martin Lings, and I hope this film has given us some deeper insight both into the author himself and his lifelong scholarship and devotion to the work of William Shakespeare.